Well, welcome to Our World Today, ourworldtodaytv.org, a progressive political show imagining a better tomorrow. I'm Suzanne Linton, and we have two wonderful guests, return guests. George Crocker from the North American Water Office and John LaForge from Nukewatch. And Fukushima, or we say Fukushima, Roulette. It's about nuclear energy, and we have good stories and an update. So, interesting show. So what happened with Fukushima? How did we get this mess?
Well, I'm sure a lot of your viewers know about the initial catastrophe there.
The earthquake.
March 11th, yes. 2011. The largest earthquake in Japanese history, the fifth largest in world history, 9.0 magnitude earthquake, rocked the northeast coast of Japan and created a tsunami that smashed the coast 45 minutes to an hour and a half later. The earthquake itself destroyed much of the underground superstructure of the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power reactor complex, a six-reactor complex on the coast, well before
this. Is that big, six-reactor?
That's very big, yes. Ah. Yeah.
For comparison, Prairie Island is the largest nuclear complex in Minnesota, and that has two reactors.
Oh, my.
Monticello, which, by the way, has reactors very identical to the Fukushima reactors made by GE, their boiling water reactors. That's only one reactor.
Oh, my.
So there's six
at
this site.
And six. Mm-hmm.
And
in Fukushima.
Four were operating at the time. Two had been shut down. One was not running, but it was in temporary shutdown for repairs, reactor four there. But reactors one, two, and three all suffered total fuel meltdown, and we sometimes say melt through because the burning uranium fuel that got overheated for lack of cooling water melted right through the bottom of three reactor containment vessels and fell into the soil. The groundwater, in fact, is my estimation, is the estimation of many experts who have been analyzing this accident for 2.5 years now. And that is the reason that so much radioactive water is still gushing into the Pacific Ocean. 300 tons of highly contaminated water spews into the Pacific every day now because it's running through this complex of destroyed reactors, which are constantly being cooled by tons of water to keep the fuel from melting any further. The water is actually running through the system back to the ocean. Groundwater as well is rushing from the mountains under these machines into the reactor complex and then out again because the superstructure, as I said, underneath has been so terribly smashed up by the earthquake.
My.
One of the reasons why the events unfolded the way they did is because, you know, even though the nuclear industry has such utmost confidence in their ability to manage things, they did the foolish thing of putting their backup generators right next to their seawall. And so not only did they lose their primary power right immediately during the event, but their backup emergency power systems were also wiped out with the same event. So they had no power. And you may recall at the time they kept talking for days afterwards, they were talking about how to get cables in there to run the pumps and the other machinery that they needed to attempt to begin a recovery.
Right, so when the...
Just a design flaw. I mean, just basic, fundamental, stupid engineering.
Yes.
They put these backup generators in the basement, which were the first buildings to flood when the tsunami hit, destroying this backup power. There's another set of reactors, Fukushima number two, which is just a couple of miles away, which was saved from the exact same disaster by just one power line, which managed to maintain electric power, circulating cooling water around the reactors.
Okay.
Unlike at Fukushima Daiichi, where all the power was lost, the coolant was stopped. There was no more cooling water circulating, which caused this overheating and the melting of three reactors. Well, as a result of that, it was enormous amounts of radioactive materials were spewed to the environment, both into the Pacific Ocean and to the atmosphere. And the winds, at first blowing toward the sea, turned and moved this cloud of cesium-137 and 134 and iodine-131, these radioactive contaminants, spewed them all over the northeast part of the main Japanese island for days and days. The wind blew this material all across Japan, contaminating, we know now, up to 600,000 square kilometers of topsoil. That's about 440 square miles. You could say it's equivalent of the area of Chicago.
Mm. And this is it just in the beginning?
Yes. Well, the problem with such a massive contamination of soil is that children walk on it, infants play in it and often eat it if it's in a playground. You know, everything goes in the baby's mouth when she's playing on the ground. And so at schoolyards in particular, Japanese government officials decided to remove some of the topsoil at all the school playgrounds in the restricted zone. They created a no-go zone around.
Well,
160,000 were evacuated from an area where no one will live again. That area is just off limits. But even well outside this area of 20 kilometers, about 12 miles, there's contamination of the soil and the surface water.
And plutonium has been found 40 kilometers from the site. And plutonium is a particularly heinous fission byproduct. Once it's in the system, why it will cause cancer,
even
a particle of it, if it gets in the system.
Yeah, some of your viewers may have seen the one or two or even all three of the explosions that happened at these reactors. They exploded from a buildup of hydrogen gas in certain parts of the complexes. And as George said, one of these explosions spread plutonium far and wide because this reactor, I believe it was reactor number 3, was using a mixed fuel, not just all uranium fuel like most of the U.S. reactors, but it was using an experimental mixed oxide fuel, it's called, in which its uranium is mixed with waste plutonium. And that's why plutonium itself has been found far outside the exclusion zone. And so that stays in the environment for a quarter of a million years, working its way up.
A quarter of a million years.
Well, yes, it's half radioactive. Half-life is 24,000.
So that's 250 million.
You have to multiply that by 10 before a particular element might be decayed away to something else. Another long-lived isotope is cesium-137, one I mentioned earlier. That stays in the environment for 300 years. And now the cesium is easy to track and to find when it's being dispersed in fish. This phenomenon has been proven already that bluefin tuna that traveled the whole distance across the Pacific Ocean, contaminated with cesium from Fukushima, has been caught off the coast of Japan. Coast of California already, I'm sorry.
Yes.
And albacore tuna has been found contaminated with the same 137 cesium caught off the coast of Washington and Oregon. So this contamination of the fishery in the Pacific is well underway. And as I say, it's increasing every single day because more and more 300 tons of this contaminated water enters the Pacific every day.
So
it's unrelenting.
What happens to people when they eat the fish contaminated?
Well, cesium is one of those agents that migrates. Once it's ingested into the body, it concentrates in the fatty tissues, and it stays there. Its residence time in the body is long enough to cause cancers. Mm. And so what we're seeing is literally the dissolution of the web of life, you might say. As this radiation continues to contaminate the earth and the ocean, and more life cycles are disrupted, more and more reproductive cycles are disrupted.
Yeah.
And there's no stopping it. There is no way to mitigate against what's going on. There are no technological fixes. To illustrate that, one of the things that they're trying to do to prevent the water from flowing, and this isn't even dealing with the fact that these structures still have the fuel that hasn't already gotten out and into the ocean, but just the migrating water through the aquifer, they're talking about making what they call an ice dam. In other words, for a long stretch of Earth, between the reactors and the ocean, they'll be drilling holes deep into the Earth, putting coils down there, and then freezing the Earth to make a frozen barrier to keep the water that's now going directly into the ocean, to keep it behind this frozen berm. Well, that won't even be done if they do it for two more years. And they'll have to build another nuke or two or three just to power their cooling system. So it's there's no, the die is cast.
They'll have to build another nuke
to
power this.
Well, they'll have to power it, and it'll be a very, very energy intense application to do it.
And that's to prevent more of this.
Well, it's the kind of thing that you do when you can't do anything else, but you have to do something. It has nothing to do with what it will actually prevent or contain. It has everything to do with the politics of saying, see, we're doing stuff.
Oh, right. Exactly.
Oh. Yeah, you can imagine how much water is moving through the groundwater and moving through these reactors, because they're dumping hundreds of tons on the fuel every day to cool it. And so this ice dam idea is rather like a finger in the dike. The water's going to move around. It's supposed to be a mile long. Yeah. Does water move more than a mile underwater?
Yeah.
Ask any water geologist underground.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, you ask what's happening with the people who eat contaminated fish. Well, and that's a very important question, because the answer
Japan,
is so.
What hope is there for those people?
Well, some people are making estimates. I just got this report the other day. What is it? October 7th, a report in the Vancouver, Canada weekly newspaper called the Georgia Strait. And these analysts say that at least 800 people around the world could develop cancer from eating fish caught in Japan's waters. Of course, the fish closest to Japan, many of them have been banned, pardon me, by the government for consumption, but some yet have not.
So, well, how can you ban some and not others?
They invented this arbitrary cutoff line. If the fish flesh has 100 becquerels per kilogram of cesium, then it's off limits. If it's less than 100 becquerels, it's one of those.
99 is okay.
The U.S. has a far worse standard, actually. It's very interesting. The U.S. allows 1,200 becquerels per kilogram in the same fish. So, in fact, Japanese fishermen can be exporting fish not allowed for their consumption to the U.S. where we can eat them. So our standards need to improve as well.
In this context, it's important to understand, I think, that our own National Academies of Science came out with their beer reports, the biological effects of ionizing radiation. The Beer 7 report was 2006, mm-hmm. At which it was established conclusively from a scientific perspective that every exposure to every radiation exposure increases the risk of cancers and other disease symptoms, which means that there's really no safe dose, because every dose increases the risk. And so that's the context to understand that we have 14,000 Hiroshimas, the equivalent of 14,000 Hiroshimas
14,000
worth of radiation.
Times worse, more radiation than Hiroshima?
Yes. And it's all loose. And there's nothing to do about it.
So it's in the air.
In the water.
It's in the water, in the soil.
And in the water, it bioaccumulates as it goes from the smaller fish, which are consumed by bigger fish. And so by the time it gets the bluefin tuna or albacore tuna, the concentration.
It's pretty intense.
Pretty intense, and it's going to get worse over time, because as George said, this is just an ongoing radiation disaster. They haven't figured out how to stop this leak yet, and it's 2.5 years.
Well, what
in.
About when vegetables are planted in the soil?
Well, Well, the same problems occurred right away. There were many, many vegetables banned for a short time in Japan until the topsoil contamination was removed. Now, that sort of begs the question, too, doesn't what did they do with all that? Well, they have put some of it in bags, some of it in metal boxes, and the official government proposal is to incinerate this contaminated soil at various spots around the country to actually spread the burden of having done this to the entire culture, which is sort of astounding that you'd transport it with the risk of transportation crashes and whatnot to all parts of the Japanese archipelago and then incinerate it. The cities who have been chosen as incineration sites are protesting this policy. It hasn't been enacted yet. Meanwhile, these bags and boxes just pile up where it's been collected.
Well, I'm wondering, too, about, you know, the rain cycle, like the evaporation. Okay, it's all in the water. Well, it evaporates, it goes up into the sky, then it rains and it comes back down and doesn't seep back into the soil. And
that's a great question. You know, it's part of the places that have been decontaminated are recontaminated again, because a heavy rain in the mountains will bring down litter and leaves and, you know, fallen stuff from trees, which is still contaminated, and they have to do it all over again. This repeats every time it rains.
And meanwhile, there's no containment for any of those reactors that exploded, which means that they're still hot. There's still water. As they pump water on it, the water flashes to steam. So we're making clouds of radioactively contaminated
water.
Right,
so all the water we're putting on there
now,
to
most
cool it is,
It adds to the burden of radiation. Most of the time, the prevailing winds are blowing that towards the United States, towards the North American continent. Right. Tokyo's, though, is only 200 miles away. And sometimes the winds blow inland.
Yeah.
And when you have an ongoing generation of radioactive clouds that at particular times then have those clouds migrating across these very densely populated areas, radiation sickness is becoming increasingly common. And we don't hear about it. This issue should be on the national news of every major media outlet on a daily basis to help people understand what's going on and what really are the risks and dangers associated with this commitment to nuclear power. But we don't.
I totally agree with you, George, on that. I remember, for example, remember the Iranian hostage crisis where the U.S. people were every day there's an update.
That's
how this should be covered, too. What happened at Fukushima today, or what fish caught today was found with 25,000 times the allowable amount of cesium, which has happened already. These should be daily news banners on every television network. But of course, in this country, nuclear reactor builders and operators own two of the television networks. So you can see a built-in protection of the racket from the get-go. One thing I wanted to mention before we leave Fukushima, I know we want to move on to other things.
I have another question, too.
I mentioned this evacuation of 160,000 from a 12-mile radius. Even that is totally inadequate for the people of Japan. One thing a lot of people may not know is that the standard of contamination used for evacuation after Chernobyl was three times more strict than they're using in Japan. And why is that? Because the population density is much larger in Japan. And to evacuate to the same standard as was done in Chernobyl would require billions of more dollars, would disrupt hundreds of thousands of more people. And the government would rather expose these people to lifelong risks of cancer and immune deficiency and other illnesses than to order them evacuated.
Well, I'm speechless. I'm wondering, too, other issues of, nuclear things. I've heard about birth defects and genetic things happening to the plants and birth defects in animals and people.
Well, we have an ongoing experiment now. It's all we got to do is start keeping track and taking notes and making a record. But we usually don't do that with this stuff.
Right. So that isn't being done.
Well, most of this epidemiology that is being done about, say, birth abnormalities or or infant death or premature mortality is being done by independent analysts. I'm thinking Joe Mangano, whose great research is available at radiation.org.
Okay.
His group is Radiation and Public Health Project, radiation.org. He's done studies that show that infant mortality, that's the death of a child less than 1 year old, increases in the counties surrounding a reactor once it starts up, and that goes back down to normal. Infant mortality returns to normal levels after the reactors are shut down. Now, that's just a statistical analysis of birth deaths, infant mortality, and it doesn't show you a proof positive, but it does beg the question, what caused these infant mortalities otherwise? What's the industry's explanation for this skyrocketing of infant mortality around reactors? And those studies are available. They've been published in peer-reviewed journals, and they're available at radiation.org.
Interesting. Well, is there any hope for the population of that island of Japan? I mean, I don't see how they can, in the long run, in like 50 years, 100 years, what's going to happen to those people?
There's serious analysis that says that the entire island will be a sacrifice zone. I mean, it will not be habitable over time. And you can also make the argument that as this radiation spreads and there's no way to stop it from spreading, we may have created a sacrifice zone for the Earth as well, for life pretty much as we know it. I mean, we may
the whole globe.
The types of support systems that modern human society, human civilization needs are being seriously eroded and degraded by this event. And whether or not that erosion and that degradation is enough to collapse civilization as we know it is an open question.
Wow.
In the short term, George might be right about the long term, which might be sooner than we hope.
Yes.
But in the short term, there is some really good results going on in Japan. I mean, there's a massive public uproar about the possibility of restarting these shutdown reactors. All 54 of Japan's formerly operating reactors have been shut down because of this event.
Yes.
And the public wants it to keep shut, wants those reactors kept shut down, even though the newly elected government, recently elected, is all in favor of restarting them a little bit at a time. Every Friday, there's a massive demonstration at the Prime Minister's residence, something that's historically unheard of in Japan. Public protest is very rare, but now, because of this, there are regular Friday protests involving tens, hundreds of thousands of people saying, keep these reactors shut down, especially because Japan is an earthquake-happy place.
Yes.
There's 10 or 12 earthquakes every day in Japan. The word tsunami is a Japanese word from ancient times because Japan's history is peppered with tsunamis that have smashed the island over the years. Nonetheless, they put all these reactors on the seacoasts, and they're all vulnerable to this sort of a repeat act.
So it was a setup. I mean, you know, it was kind of almost predictable that
it was
bound to happen.
Yep.
Oh, my gosh.
Well, it was rather predicted, too. Even our own Nuclear Regulatory Commission says that one of these events can be expected every 50 years. Now we've seen one every 7 years since the beginning of the nuclear age.
And it's not very much in our news. And, what you're talking about now, I don't hear it. And, I really try to get at the core of what's going on. And I'm not hearing what you're saying.
Well, the cover-up is going on, but if you scour the Japanese newspapers, which you can see online, and the environmental newspapers that cover nuclear issues, you can find out about it. But it's like a part-time job just to do that.
Yes, exactly.
And there are websites and bloggers that do put out good information.
Yes.
I don't know, maybe some of those websites.
We're going to have a list of websites shown during, during the show or at the end of the show. So
look for that.
Yeah, look for that. But Well,
the information is available if you, like John says,
yes,
make it your part-time job to find it.
Yes, but what I'm concerned about is just like the general population.
Clueless.
Clueless. Yeah. So.
Well, we work hard to try to get the word out. Nukewatch publishes a quarterly newsletter. It doesn't have a huge mailing list like Newsweek or Vogue or Time magazine. But people can check out our magazine online, too, which
yes.
It's nukewatchinfo.org.
Yes.
And the scientists that are covering these things and doing the hard mathematics that we have a great respect for are that at the Institute for Energy and Environmental Research, IEER.org. Mm-hmm. Great work that they do.
We've had a representative from them,
yep,
from there, do a show here,
great,
too. She was great.
Christina Mills.
Yes, that was her name. Thank you. Okay, now we can move on to the clip, I think. Not quite yet, but
sure.
Do you want to introduce, you brought a clip.
Yep.
Which shows that nuclear energy is on its way out, more or less. But, you know, you want to introduce the person?
In March of this year, Jeremy Rifkin, who's a world-renowned energy analyst and an advisor to the European Union and many of the presidents of the European Union over the last 10 years on energy security issues, answered a question which is posed all the time. Can't nuclear power save us from the carbon of a coal-powered electric grid?
Yes.
And he, in about 4 minutes, that's how long the clip is, he analyzes the total unlikelihood of a nuclear renaissance, as
yes,
it's being called.
Yes, the nuclear renaissance. Well, Bring more of it back.
The idea is that there are those who purport that nuclear power is the clean alternative to prevent climate chaos or global warming or whatever
yes.
you want to call it. And this clip just does a very artful job of debunking that particular misconception.
Okay, good. Yeah. Let's watch it.
I have a question for Jeremy. My name is Boris Vizhangurazov. I'm from Kazina Capital Management, part of Sovereign Wealth Fund of Kazakhstan. What would be your view on nuclear energy, given that it's a non-carbon, and there are new technologies that can basically be very, very safe, I mean, to some extent, and can be quite efficient in terms of, getting energy from uranium?
I don't spend much time on nuclear technology unless someone asks me about it, because frankly, I think from a business perspective, it's over. I think it's over. Let me explain why. There may be a lot of ideological issues, but from a business perspective, here's the situation. Nuclear power was pretty well dead in the water in the 1980s after Three Mile Island and Chernobyl. It had a comeback. The comeback was the industry said, we are part of the solution for climate change because we don't emit CO2 with nuclear. It's polluting, but there's no CO2. Here's the issue, though. All of our scientific projections are interesting on this. Nuclear power right now is 6% of the energy of the world. There are only 400 nuclear power plants. They rely on 6% of the energy of the world. And these are old nuclear power plants. But our scientists tell us to have a minimum impact on climate change, which is the whole rationale for bringing this technology back. Nuclear would have to be 20% of the energy mix to have the minimum impact on climate change, not 6% of the mix. That means we'd have to replace the existing 400 nuclear plants and build 1,600 additional plants. Three nuclear plants have to be built every 30 days for 40 years to get to 20%. And by that time, climate change will have run its course for us. So I think from a business point of view, I just don't see that investment. I'd be surprised if we replace 100 of the 400 existing plants, which would take us down to 1% or 2% of the energy. Number two, we still don't know how to recycle the nuclear waste, and we're 70 years in. Now, we have good engineers in the U.S. We spent 18 years and $8 billion building an underground vault in Yucca Mountain to store the waste for 10,000 years. We can't use it. We can't even store them. It's already no good because there are cracks in the mountain. But any geologist could have told them, we live on tectonic plates. You can't keep underground vaults secure. Number three, we run into uranium deficits, according to the International Atomic Energy Commission, you may know this, between 2025 and 2035, with just the existing 400 plants. So that means the price goes up. Number four, we could do what the French generation of new plants are doing, and we cycle the uranium to plutonium. But then we have plutonium all over the world in an age of uncertainty and terrorism. And then finally, and this is the big one that people don't realize, we don't have the water. Over 40% of all the fresh water consumed in France each year goes to cooling the nuclear reactors. It's almost 50% now. When it comes back, it's heated and it's dehydrating our agricultural and ecosystems and it's threatening our agriculture. So we don't have the water, and this is true all over the world. We have saltwater nuclear plants, but then you have to put them on coastal regions and you risk a Fukushima because of tsunamis and ocean currents. And I would say the last thing on this is that nuclear power is centralized power. We'll talk about this tonight, like fossil fuels. It doesn't fit a new generation that's moving with the kind of technologies that are distributed, collaborative, and laterally scaled. It's an old technology. So it's no accident Siemens is out, Germany is out, Italy is out, Japan is now out. And I think with President Hollande's election, I met with him in the spring, they're moving toward a third industrial revolution model in France. I think I'd be surprised if nuclear has much of a life left. I don't think it's a good business deal.
I agree with you.
Any comments after that?
Jeremy does it nicely.
Yes. Yes. That's a good clip.
Yeah, that last point about water is very important. 40% of France is drinking water. That's a heavy, heavy thing that people don't realize. And that it leads me to this hearing
yes,
that I attended
yes,
in Canada.
Yes, we were going to talk about a hearing you went to in Toronto.
Our drinking water is in danger, too. The Great Lakes, right now, the chain of Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence Seaway, has over 33 nuclear reactors on its shoreline. It's along between the U.S. and Canada. And most recently, the Ontario government is considering digging a deep geologic dump, deep underground dump, we call it DUD, up right on the shore of Lake Huron, the eastern shore of the lower part of Lake Huron, which is a place called the Bruce Peninsula. It's a beautiful area. The Bruce nuclear complex has 8 reactors operating there.
8?
Some of them are shut down, I believe. It's one of the biggest reactor complexes in the world. Japan has a bigger one, but they're all shut down at the moment. So currently it's the biggest reactor complex in the world. For convenience and to save money, they want to put this 2,000-foot deep hole a mile from the shore of Lake Huron, right by the Bruce reactor complex, and then transfer this stuff in transport casks. They're not saying that the cask is going to hold the waste, but that the cavern underground, which is limestone, believe it or not, is going to contain the waste, that the canister is just for transport purposes, not for containment. So this is sort of shocking information. 40 million people rely on the Great Lakes for drinking water. Everything downstream from Lake Huron would be affected by an accident. And so there is a lot of opposition in Canada and the U.S. Hundreds of people testified between September and October at these public hearings west of Toronto. And I got a chance to participate and testified in opposition to the plan. And in preparation for it, I read a public pamphlet that the company itself, Ontario Power Generation, OPG, had distributed for public hearings during the summer. Mm-hmm. And right in it, it says, oh, this waste will not contaminate drinking water at all. But, and then it said, but, even if the entire volume, which is 200,000 cubic meters, of this low and intermediate level radioactive waste was dissolved in Lake Huron, the individual dose to any given person would be 100 times less than the allowable limit. And this is a staggering statement in a public pamphlet. It seems like something out of a cartoon, like a joke.
Yes.
But it wasn't. It was dead serious. So I read this statement to the panelist that was taking the testimony in October. And I said, this is a shocking presentation from the company that created all this waste, and I just was wondering if the panel had an opinion on this. Why would you, as the Ontario government, spend $1 billion to build this very elaborate hole in the ground when it's perfectly safe to throw this water in, throw this waste in the water? You know, it's a rhetorical question, but it was begged by this pamphlet put out by the company. The union people that are tasked with constructing this dump site and moving this stuff into it also had quite a lackadaisical attitude toward radiation risk. I asked them about George's statement earlier that the National Academy says there's no safe dose. So I asked the union guys if they share the Academy's opinion on the risk coming from even the smallest dose, the risk of causing cancer from even one inhaled or ingested radioactive particle. And the head of the Nuclear Workers Council for Canada said, oh, the doses are so low, we don't care about it.
These are the unions.
Yeah. That was very disappointing. Most of the time you think that union stewards and union membership and leadership especially would be deeply concerned about the health and environment of their crew.
The other aspect of the water issue that Jeremy mentioned in the clip has to do with the fact that every reactor consumes huge amounts of water to keep cool. They need to have very, very large, millions of gallons of water a day to cool the reactor. And what happens if you don't cool it, of course, we're now experiencing at Fukushima. So they need all of this water, but we're also moving into this era of altered climate where we don't have the same precipitation patterns that we have historically. So all of these reactors, they're built by the oceans or on the rivers or by large lakes, the Great Lakes. And what happened several years ago during the intense heat in France that they had and the dry conditions there, they had to shut their reactors off because there wasn't enough water in the rivers to keep them cool. They had to shut them down. So not only do we have, you know, these threats from just the reactor operations themselves, but they jeopardize, as Jeremy said, our ability to even feed ourselves because we don't have enough water to grow the food if we make this commitment to continue keeping cores from melting. Pretty bizarre.
Very.
So that leads us to the fact that, again, as Jeremy mentioned in the clip, the United States had a program going to dump the irradiated fuel, the high-level waste, at a repository, they called it, at Yucca Mountain in Nevada, on western Shoshone land that should be protected by the Treaty of Ruby Valley from 1867, but
never mind.
We never mind about treaties, I guess. Anyway, that program was defunded by Congress because of all of the corruption involved, because of the scientific issues that were raised by it. There was no longer money appropriated by Congress under Senator Reid's leadership to continue with the Yucca Mountain adventure. And that leaves the United States without a waste management program, essentially. It's a de facto program that just sticks irradiated fuel from fuel pools. As the fuel pools fill up at each reactor site, they put them into storage canisters adjacent to the reactors. And that's what we're doing now around the country. That's the waste management program that we are operating under. So the attempt is to reestablish confidence in our waste management program. And to establish confidence in order to refund the waste management issue or the development, why the Nuclear Regulatory Commission is trotting around the country having hearings that they call waste management confidence hearings, which they have to do in order to create the record that they can go back to Congress and say, see, we now have confidence in our waste management program, so give us some more money to do it. The problem, and we had one scheduled here for Minnesota, in Minnetonka, which was scheduled for this coming Thursday, but we had to cancel it because the government shut down.
Yes.
So there's a little irony there if you care to think about that a bit.
Yes.
But the point here is that there will be a rescheduled hearing in
so
Minnesota.
So this is something for the public.
So we need to do a little organizing. Keep advised. There's a website operated by the Nuclear Information Resource Services, NIRS.org, which has been our point of contact for scheduling and organizing. They're managing the issue all over the country for these hearings. As soon as these hearings for Minnesota are rescheduled, we would very much like to help people understand that there's an opportunity to present evidence and testimony to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission about this. But people have to pre-register. You have to register 3 days, I think it is, before. You can't just show up and give them a piece of your mind. You know, you got to register beforehand. So we need to do some organizing. Again, the website to be paying attention to, NIRS.org, Nuclear Information Resource Service.
Okay.
So that's...
Yes, and Minnesota was high on the list for the second repository when the first round of scoping hearings took place back in the 80s. Maybe that was even before Yucca was chosen.
It was.
There was a whole list of states that were being considered. And Minnesota, with a large body of very old granite bedrock, was high on the list. And that's where I first saw the renowned Winona LaDuke in action, the vice presidential candidate and author from White Earth.
Yeah.
She got up in front of the NRC officials with what looked like aluminum foil sub sandwich from some submarine sandwich shop. And she told the NRC, this is a nuclear suppository. And then she sat back down, sort of spoke for itself. It's great sense of humor, and that's basically what we need to remind the NRC of, that this is their problem. They created it by, as you say, setting up this roulette game that we get to play, but we don't have to be a site for underground burial of highly radioactive, ferociously radioactive waste fuel rods from nuclear reactors when there's so much water in Minnesota and Wisconsin that make it inevitable that it would leak.
The fundamental problem here is, of course, that we've already committed to all of this volume of waste. It's already in existence. So how do we bequeath that to posterity? I mean, that's a question. So we do need a waste management program. From my perspective, there is no waste management program that can possibly have any integrity unless and until we stop making more, particularly allowing profits to be made by making more, which is the problem with it. We need to take the profitability out of it. We need to stop generating it. Once there's a finite, defined volume of material, then perhaps we can get our minds around where should the sacrifice zone be to put this stuff. What is the technology that we will use to bequeath it to posterity? How should those who now abide in the sacrifice zone be compensated for leaving it? But those are the kinds of questions that a rational nuclear waste management program needs to grapple with, as opposed to where should we dig a hole to put it out of sight and out of mind, which is sort of what the NRC mentality is.
Yeah, I agree with George there. The current push to find some interim storage sites or hide it someplace is mainly a means of clearing out the cooling pools where the freshly hot waste gets put to keep a reactor running.
Yes.
They have to replace one-third of the fuel on a regular basis every 18 months.
About, depending. Yep.
And so this hot waste comes out of those reactors, has to go in a cooling pool. Well, they're full. After 40 years of operation, most of these reactors in our country are 35, 40 years old. These pools are full. They need to move that waste along in order to keep the reactor running. So all this push to find a waste burial hiding place is just a means right now of keeping reactors operating. And
of
so George is absolutely right.
Yeah.
We need a broad public uproar calling for the shutdown of the reactors.
Right.
Then there'll be money and expertise and enough time left to start thinking about how to deal with the waste. And
yes,
I want to throw in that keeping it above ground in a monitored, retrievable, observable context, maybe hardened and protected against wacky bomb throwers or terrorists, is preferable to hiding it underground where if it leaks, it's too late and nothing to be done. If it leaks above ground where it can be observed, then it can be repackaged.
Oh.
And
putting it underground, then, you know, you can't see it, then it doesn't exist sort of idea.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, because in your clip, you know, it was explaining all the facts of why it isn't such a good thing, and it's people have known it for so long, and all the countries that have shut down, did they say France and Germany and now Japan? And
France, not yet.
Not yet.
Germany has.
Italy. He didn't mention Switzerland as well.
So Germany, Italy, Switzerland, Japan, and Brazil are already shutting down, and they're taking a square look at it.
Yeah.
But it sounds like the United States is still focusing on continuing.
Well, they're trying to squeeze every nickel they have out of the existing infrastructure. We haven't had any new reactors. There's an attempt to build a couple new ones in South Carolina and sometimes in Texas. The problem is that it's simply too expensive. I mean, the price of energy from a new reactor would be well above 10 cents a kilowatt hour, just to start with. These things will be costing. I mean, for example, the cost per megawatt of capacity for wind turbines right now is you know, the high side is around $2,000 per kilowatt, or $20,000, well, whatever the numbers are.
Yeah.
With reactors, instead of $2,000 per kilowatt, it's well north of 10,000 per kilowatt for that capacity.
Well, then why has not the United States gone like other countries and said, done?
Well, in fact, Wall Street has. Wall Street won't put a dime into a new nuclear reactor unless it's got total federal loan guarantees backing it all the way up to Christmas.
Oh.
They won't do a thing. The two that are under construction on and off again near Georgia, they have an $8.5 billion loan guarantee. That's the only reason they're off the ground at all. Because Wall Street is saying just what Jeremy Rifkin said.
Too risky,
too expensive, and at the moment, unfortunately, because of the cheapness of frack gas, gas-powered electricity is much cheaper than nuclear, and that's pushing nuclear right out off the.
But why aren't we shutting down?
Because we've already made, as a society, we've already made those investments. Once the capital formation is in place, they're relatively cheap to operate. It's sort of like anything's cheap if you don't pay for it. And so so we're operating these reactors, not counting their capital costs, not counting the waste management costs, and not counting the cost of routine operations in terms of routine releases of radionuclides, which is another item that we need to talk about here a little bit tonight.
Yeah, I know we don't have much time.
Well, there's one more reason why we're out, why this country isn't going that way.
Between Germany and the United States in facing this,
is that the industry is so politically powerful.
The
American University analyst Judith Pasternak did a terrific study about 4 years ago about how much money the industry has used lobbying Congress and electing representatives. They spent $640 million over 10 years telling Congress that nuclear power is the answer to climate change.
Yes.
And so that's the only people you hear it from. State legislators, federal lawmakers, and commercial television where the utilities buy their own propaganda. Everybody else is a little bit skeptical, and so it's strictly a matter of lobbying money. That's a lot of money, $64 million a year for 10 years. That's why we hear about it. Now, in Germany, where they're still feeling the effects of Chernobyl contamination, cesium is still making wild boar hunting illegal in Germany. That used to be a great sports activity to hunt wild boar. They're full of cesium, so you can't eat that meat. Some years after Chernobyl. So Germany knows a lot about the dangers of nuclear power. And when Fukushima happened, the public said, that's it. And the prime minister, who happens to be a physicist, didn't help. It didn't hurt that she was a physicist, because she read the writing on the wall, too. And by 2022, Germany will have 30% of its power from renewable, from wind and solar. This country could do that as well.
Yeah.
We just need a public that is as conscious of the dangers of radiation as the German public is.
And aware, and then there's a news cover-up and whatever.
That's right, yeah.
I see. So we have a few minutes left for our last thoughts on why we need a right to know movement. Or
well, it's part of what I think people should be thinking about, because every reactor routinely releases large amounts of radiation to the air and the water. When we talk about nuclear waste,
people don't know this.
Most of the time, when we talk about nuclear waste, almost all of the time, we're talking about the solid waste.
Mm-hmm.
That's the fuel rods, the spent fuel rods.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when uranium atoms explode to create the heat to make the steam to spin the turbine to generate the electricity, why the uranium atom typically blows apart into two big chunks and a bunch of debris. And in that mix is every element on the periodic chart that you remember from high school chemistry, and all of the radioactive sons and daughters. And some of those are liquids and some of those are gases. And those liquids and gases, fission products, high-level nuclear waste, we dump into the air routinely and dump into the water routinely, and they're reported to the NRC. And as a society, we have agreed that the federal government can set limits to how much they can dump, and the states do not have a right to challenge those limits. There's a federal preemption to it, but that's the commitment we've made. So they have a right to do it according to the law of the land.
Yes.
Okay, so they got a right to do it, but the public, from my perspective, has a right to know.
Exactly.
Just like when you walk into the grocery store, you know, you have a right to know what's in the food that you're buying. There's labels mm-hmm. on it. We kill about 50,000 people a year in this country driving down the roads, but still, we put signs on the highway. People have a right to know if there's a hill or a bend in the highway. There's a right to know. Well, just like that, I think people have a right to know if they, say, want to drive from Minneapolis to La Crosse. They have a right to know whether or not this is a good day to drive down the River Valley where the Prairie Island reactors have just released radiation and the plume is identifiable. We know that we can monitor this radiation with exquisite detail. Fukushima shows that. The spy mm-hmm. who got killed with polonium-210 and was mm-hmm. traced all over Europe months later demonstrate that. The way we monitor North Korea demonstrates that. We know how to track radiation.
Right.
What the public has a right to know in real time, considering that there are releases that happen routinely and are reported, the public has a right to know where the hotspots are, what is the plume at any point in time, what is the definition of that release pattern. And that could be done with some state legislation. And so I just really encourage people to contact their legislators, talk with them about right to know, their radiation environment.
Okay, that's it. That's how you word that.
Well, that's
the radiation environment.
Yep. Monitor for real time, so that you
monitor for real time
radiation dispersion patterns is what we're aiming for.
Okay, radiation dispersion patterns.
Yeah, that reminds me of what happened. One of the things that happened after Fukushima, in Japan, was that. Right away in this country, the Environmental Protection Agency and the Nuclear Regulatory Commission established an emergency reporting system to let people know about the contamination that was reaching the United States. As George pointed out, iodine-131 is one of the gases, the radioactive gases, that's dispersed in huge amounts after an accident like this, and iodine reached the United States. So the EPA was checking every single day iodine levels mm-hmm. on the California, Oregon, and Washington coast, and it was reported having been picked up in drinking water all across the United States. People can go and look
wow.
at the
news accounts. Is this from rainfall that
yes.
carries it?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
Well, what happened on, this happened March 11th, you recall. 2 months later, May 16th, the NRC announced that its 24-hour-a-day operations center would be shut down, and monitoring the reactors was going to be suspended because they said the reactors there are slowly stabilizing, quote unquote. That was a true statement, just a little miserly with the facts, because it's still out of control. According to the United Nations Atomic Energy Agency, just last week said that they are not in control of those reactors yet. So it's slowly stabilizing. Well, as Kevin Camps has said, he's with Beyond Nuclear, that's beyondnuclear.org, a nuclear waste specialist with them. He said, now once every 3 months, the government is looking at the milk supply in this country to report on contamination. And once a month, it will look at rainwater. So once every 3 months, it's looking at milk. That's totally inadequate, considering the effects of radiation on infants and children is much more severe than on adults, and it's children and infants who drink so much milk. Well, the government doesn't want to know what's in the air and the water and the food supply, and it doesn't want us to know. That's the only conclusion you can reach when they shut down the monitoring that should be going on and reported to us.
Because the risk would be then to shut down those,
well, if people,
those businesses that are making money.
Yeah, lots
if,
of money.
If people understood why they should be concerned about radiation in their environment, and understood that every reactor is routinely putting radiation into their environment, it seems to me that an informed public would start to question about why are we allowing that type of insult to the air we breathe and the water we drink and the food we eat. And it may be that if people were sensitive enough and informed enough about what are the dispersion patterns from routine releases, not questioning the right of the power companies to contaminate because we've already made that decision, but informed about where the hot spots are. Are they living? Would you want to buy a house in an area that routinely accumulates radiation downwind from Prairie Island reactors or from Monticello? Maybe not. Maybe, but maybe not. But that you have a right to know that. You have a right to know whether the house that you want to buy is in a area that is routinely contaminated when routine releases come from the reactor. That's the point. The idea would be to contact your legislators and help
state
us.
State legislators say we have a right to know.
We have a right to know.
The contamination levels.
Yep. In real time.
In real time. Well, I'm speechless. What a wonderful show. Thank you so much, John LaForge and George Crocker.
You're welcome.
Great show. Thanks for tuning in, and go to our website, ourworldtodaytv.org, and go to all these websites that are now on the screen, and let's keep on top of this information. Thank you. Good night.